Well, good evening, and welcome to the final event in this year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, Director of the Hall Centre, which puts the series together. It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr., Alphonse Fletcher University Professor at Harvard University. Professor Gates will take questions after his talk, if you would make your way to one of the two microphones. After the talk, in the room opposite this auditorium, there will be a reception for our guest speaker, who will also do a book signing. All are welcome to be there. Tonight's event is made possible by the Sosland Foundation of Kansas City. I'm grateful to the Foundation and to Morton and Estelle Sosland for their continued support of the lecture series. To introduce Dr. Gates, I called upon the Chancellor of the University, Dr. Bernadette Gray Little, and she responded with alacrity. The Chancellor hardly needs any introduction herself after 2 years in the hot seat, but allow me to remind you that Dr. Gray Little has a PhD in clinical psychology from St. Louis University. At University of North Carolina, where she spent the bulk of her academic career, she went from assistant to full professor in psychology before becoming chair of the department in 1993. Other administrative positions at UNC followed that of chair, cresting in dean of the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences from 2004 to 2006, and then executive vice chancellor and provost. At UNC, as Dean and Provost, she increased diversity, she created an Office of Undergraduate Research, and a freshman seminar program, among many other initiatives. It's my great pleasure to say, please welcome Chancellor Gray Little.
Good evening. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce one of our nation's most outstanding public intellectuals, a man whose numerous roles include professor and literary critic, scholar and writer, editor and historian, and a man who was recently named one of Time Magazine's 25 Most Influential Americans. Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr. is the Alphonse Fletcher University Professor and director of the W.E.B. Du Bois Institute for African and African American Research at Harvard University. In 2006, Dr. Gates wrote and produced the PBS documentary, African American Lives, the first documentary series to employ genealogy and science to provide an understanding of African American history. He followed that with Finding Oprah's Roots, Finding Your Own, a meditation on genetics, genealogy, and race. An influential cultural critic, Dr. Gates' publications include a 1994 cover Time story, numerous articles for The New Yorker, and a bi-weekly guest column in The New York Times. He's also editor-in-chief of the Oxford African American Studies Center, the first comprehensive scholarly online resource in the field of African American studies and Africana studies. Dr. Gates earned his MA and PhD in English Literature from Clare College at the University of Cambridge and his BA in History from Yale University. Before joining the faculty of Harvard in 1991, he taught at Yale, Cornell, and Duke. His honors include a MacArthur Foundation Genius Grant and a National Humanities Medal and 44 honorary degrees. African American identity, and therefore history, is an area of professional interest and study for me. I would like to share a brief story, and it's going to be brief, Victor, don't worry, that will perhaps deepen your understanding of the impact of this type of research. As an African American who grew up in a small segregated town in eastern North Carolina, I know that at least some of my ancestors were enslaved on one or more plantations near Georgetown, South Carolina. But that's about all that I know about them. The rest is hidden behind the wall of slavery. So while many of you here can trace your family history back many generations, the family history of those of us who were bought and sold as property often can be traced only to the end of the Civil War, if that far. My obscured family history is a reflection of the treatment of enslaved persons. Enslaved workers had no surnames. When they did have surnames, they were assigned by their owners, and those names were usually changed when they were sold to new owners. Records of births, deaths, purchases, and the sale of slaves were, for the most part, the private property of their owners and often lost to history. For these reasons, it has been difficult for my family to trace our lineage with historical accuracy. In other words, the institution of slavery has kept the true picture of our past hidden in the shadow just beyond our grasp. And this is truly a shame, because knowledge of family ancestry is integral to the human experience. Understanding our ancestry helps us connect with the past, gives us a context for understanding the world, and provides a bond between generations. And that's why Dr. Gates' research is so important. It is helping us break down that wall and reunite our past. And that's why I am deeply honored and delighted he could join us tonight to speak about African American lives, genealogy, genetics, and Black history. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr.
Thank you, Madam Chancellor. It is just a great honor to be back here. I've only been here once before. It was 20 years ago, and I had a really good time. And so good that they invited me back 20 years later. Right? But certain things have changed. One, much more diversity in the faculty and the student body. But the ultimate, the ultimate transformation, of course, is that you have a brilliant African-American female chancellor. Give it up. Stole her from North Carolina and all that good barbecue down there. Must have given her a hell of an offer. Anyway, I want to start with a little video clip, and then I'll talk to you about genealogy, genetics, and African-American history.
I'm fascinated by family trees. I even use them to teach my students here at Harvard. But it's not just an academic pursuit for me. It's a way to reclaim the past, my own past, and that of my people.
I conceived of these series as roots in a test tube, roots for the 21st century, and as a way of exploring ever more deeply what our ancestors achieved in this country and what they were forced to endure.
We're going to work our way back from the present through Reconstruction, the Civil War, to the colonial era, until our ancestors' paper trail runs out. Then, using the latest breakthroughs in DNA analysis, we're going to attempt to reverse the Middle Passage to discover our roots deep in Africa, from which our family ties were severed so very long ago. I'm taking 11 people on this journey with me. among them some faces that are very familiar, as well as some that you'll meet for the very first time. Their stories represent all of our stories, the collective narrative of our African-American lives.
You got me. And there's more?
Thank you. All right, I have, as Professor Bailey knows, we both are Cantabrigians. We went to the University of Cambridge. I have a PhD in English literature in England. It's called English Language and Literature. So I have the guy, the PhD in English, and who made his career writing about African and African-American literature. How did I end up making documentaries about genealogy and genetics? Well, in retrospect, it started the day I met this lady. Now, this is my great-great-grandmother, Jane Gates. And you can see from her birth and death dates that she was born in 1819, and she died in 1888. So obviously, I didn't meet her literally, right? But it's the day I met her through this image. And I remember the day like it was yesterday, because it was July 3rd, 1960, and I was 9 years old. And it was the day that we buried my father's father, Edward St. Lawrence Gates. Jane Gates had five children. This is her son, my great-grandfather, Edward St. Lawrence Gates, who was born just before the Civil War, 1857, and he died 5 years before I was born, 1945. And he looked like a white man. And this is his son, my grandfather, Edward St. Lawrence Gates. Now, you could look at him. He looks like a little white boy, doesn't he? And I was standing in front of his open casket, holding my father's hand. Now, I was only 9 years old. And I thought that he looked ridiculous. You could see how white he looked with blood coursing through his veins. So imagine how white he looked when he was dead. He looked like he'd been coated with alabaster and sprinkled with white baby powder, right? And so I thought he looked bizarre. Now, my father is, well, my father recently died. He died at the age of 97 and a half on Christmas Eve. So forgive me, I'll go back and forth between the past tense and the present tense. But my father was the funniest man on the face of the earth. My father made Red Fox look like an undertaker. So I heard this noise from my daddy. I was holding my daddy's hand, looking at this ridiculously white corpse, and I heard this noise, so I thought daddy thought that he looked ridiculous too, and I started to laugh. And I looked up at him, and I realized that he wasn't laughing. Now, why would I think my father was laughing? Well, let me tell you how funny my father was. When I was growing up in the 1950s, I wanted to be a Rhodes Scholar. I wanted to go to Harvard or Yale as an undergraduate, and then I wanted to go to Oxford or Cambridge. Smart little kids did that. That's what my mother told me. So that's what I wanted to do, because my mother told me I was smart, and I believed anything that she said. And so I've always been blessed, as our people say, in the classroom. And I went to junior college my freshman year, and then I transferred to Yale, and I did very well. And so senior year, I applied for every fellowship that would take me to Oxford or Cambridge. I applied for a Fulbright, a Marshall, a Casby, a Rhodes, and I was a finalist for all these fellowships. Now look, I was junior year Phi Beta Kappa. I was about to graduate summa, and I was black from West Virginia. Now you can't beat that. So I knew I was gonna get these fellowships, right? And guess what? I walked in, I mean, I was diversity in, you know, blackface. I don't know how else I'm supposed to say. I walked into all these fellowships. Oh, I forgot. I also had a 2-foot-high afro. You know my man Cornel West? Cornel West's afro is a crew cut. Next to my afro, I was Captain Black Man. Edgar, I had a closet full of dashikis too. You know I did. Remember we used to do the soul handshake? We would change it every month, like changing the computer code. Make sure you're still black. Well, anyway, I didn't get any of these fellowships. I was blowing it. I was doing something wrong. This caused a severe existential crisis in my life. So I went to my girlfriend. My girlfriend is now a very famous professor, Linda Darling. I'm sure you all, some of you know her, Linda Darling Hammond, professor of education at Stanford. We were a big junior year item in the black community. She had a big afro like Angela Davis, you know, so we were like the afro twins. And so I went to Linda and I said, am I getting any of these fellowships? You know, what am I going to do? And she said, everybody knows my name is Skip. She called me like my mother, Skippy. She said, Skippy, you're just being artificial. Go in there and be yourself. And I said, well, I don't have anything to lose because I'm down to my last fellowship. And so this is my only chance. And I went in, and ladies and gentlemen, I got that fellowship. It's one of the happiest days of my life. You know, other than the days on which my daughters, I have two daughters, were born, it was the happiest day of my life. Because I'd wanted this since I was a little kid. My cousins wanted to be Hank Aaron and Willie Mays. I wanted to be a Rhodes Scholar. And I got it. I got a Mellon Fellowship. So I went back to Calhoun College at Yale, and I called home. It was 4 o'clock in the afternoon. It was in February. I'll never forget it. 1973. And my daddy answered the phone. Now, in those days, you didn't have two phones. You had a phone and an extension phone. Remember that? I don't know what genius thought of that nomenclature, but that's the way it was. So I said, Daddy, put Mama on the extension phone. She was upstairs in our house. So Mama got on the extension phone, and I said, Mama, Daddy, you'll never believe it. You'll never believe it. I got a Mellon Fellowship. I got a Mellon Fellowship. I'm the first Afro-American. Remember, this is 1973. We were Afro-Americans. I'm the first Afro-American to get a Mellon Fellowship. I'm going to Cambridge. And my dad, without missing a beat, said, you're the first Negro to get a Mellon Fellowship? I said, yeah, Daddy. He said, huh, they're going to call it the Watermelon Fellowship from now on. I told you he was funny. So armed with my Watermelon Fellowship, I went off to the University of Cambridge. End of parenthesis. That is why I thought my father might be laughing at how ridiculously white my grandfather looked in that casket at Kite Funeral Home on Baltimore Street in the middle of Cumberland, Maryland, halfway between Pittsburgh and Washington, on July 3rd, 1960. And everybody in this funeral home was black, all the colored people, as we would have said then, because my grandfather was a very prominent man in the community. Everybody was there. So I was mortified. It was the most embarrassing day of my life because I was laughing at my grandfather's corpse. But nobody noticed me because when I looked up to see what noise my father was making, he was crying. It was the first time I ever saw my father cry. And he was just howling with grief. And so everyone forgot about me, and I was so frightened at seeing my father cry and so embarrassed at this stupid thing that I'd done, so I started to cry too. So anyway, we go off over to the Episcopal Cemetery, Rose Hill Cemetery in Cumberland, Maryland, and we bury my grandfather. And then we come back to the Gates family home, which we still own. Now, this house was bought. Jane Gates was a slave. She was a midwife. If you look closely, excuse me, you can see her midwifery uniform, her nurse's uniform. And she was freed by the 13th Amendment. You know, we're raised in elementary school and high school to think that the Emancipation Proclamation freed all the slaves. The slaves really were freed by the ratification of the 13th Amendment, which is December of 1865, and that's how she became free. And 5 years later, she plopped down $1,200 in cash in an all-white neighborhood in Cumberland, Maryland. Now, where did she get that money? She didn't get it from saving her pennies in slavery, right? And if you look at what her son looked like, you don't have to be Sherlock Holmes to figure out that a white man fathered her children, and most probably, this white man gave her the money to buy this house. So we go back to this house, and my dad takes my brother and me, I only have one brother, Dr. Paul Gates, he's 5 years older, takes us upstairs in my grandparents' house. Now, I don't know about you all, but I didn't even know my grandparents had a bedroom. You know, at night they would just disappear magically. I don't know where they went. You know, in those days, things were very formal in our community. You didn't call older black people by their first name. Even now, if I am referring to one of my mother and father's friends, long deceased, I'll call them Miss Mary, Miss Bernadette, you know, Mr. Robert. You know, you never call them by their first name. That's why, you know, among my younger colleagues at Harvard who let their students call them by their first name. To me, it's inappropriate. Students all the time say, what should I call you? I say, do not hesitate to call me professor. But in those days, you didn't go up to your grandparents' bedroom. You didn't sit on someone's bed. You didn't step on a a grave. You didn't do any of that stuff. So this is the first time that we had ever been upstairs in my grandparents' bed. And my dad said, I want to show you two boys something. So he takes us back to their bedroom, and it's still there, and takes us out onto a sun porch. And there was a beautiful cabinet out there. He opened this cabinet, and it was full of bank ledgers. My grandfather used to be the janitor at the First National Bank of Cumberland, Maryland. And he was stealing these bank ledgers, bringing them home every night, I guess. So my brother and I looked at each other initially. We thought, man, we must be rich. They're going to divide up the family fortune and tell us how much money we have. But we were soon disappointed because when my father pulled this bank ledger down, the first one, it turned out it was a scrapbook that my grandfather cut, did newspaper clippings. And he was fascinated by death. We could see, even as we stood there, that these headlines were all about death. Airplane accidents, railroad accidents. He was particularly fascinated by the war dead. Every day in the paper, the American war dead during World War II, especially local people. He clipped that every day. But he was also, in spite of the fact that he looked like a little white man, he was a race man. There were clippings of the first Negro judge in New York, 1942. He loved Congressman Adam Clayton Powell. So, you know, we're just looking at this, my dad just pulling bank ledger after bank ledger out of this wardrobe. And finally, he says, I found it. And you boys, I want you to look at this. And you know what it was? It was an obituary dated January 6, 1888. And the headline said, died this day in Cumberland, Maryland, Jane Gates, an estimable colored woman. An estimable colored woman. And then he picked out between the leaves of that same bank ledger the original of this photograph, a sepia photograph of this lady. And he said, that is the oldest Gates. She was a slave, and I never want you to forget what she looked like or who she was. Then he shut the bank ledger, put him back in the wardrobe, shut the doors of the wardrobe, and we went downstairs for the repast, which is what, you know, we do after a funeral. That night, we drove 25 miles from Cumberland, Maryland, back to Piedmont, West Virginia, where we live, and I went to bed. My father worked two jobs for 37 years. He worked in the paper mill in the daytime in our Irish-Italian paper mill town, and then he was a janitor in the evening. So we always lived very well in the colored community in our town. And it means that I always had my own bedroom, and my brother always had his own bedroom, and I always had my own desk, and I always had my own bookcase, which was very important to my mother. And right next to my bed sat my desk, and on that desk was a red Webster's Dictionary. And the last thing I did that night before I went to sleep was look up the word estimable, because I didn't know what it meant. And I thought, wow, I must be descended from someone special. The next day was the 4th of July. And as I said, Piedmont, West Virginia, in the Allegheny Mountains on the Potomac River, now it's about 2-3 hours west of D.C., halfway between Pittsburgh and D.C. It was a segregated town. Brown v. Board, it's 1954. You all know about Brown v. Board, especially here, and I met Ms. Brown. It was a great honor. Brown v. Board's 1954. Schools integrated in our county in 1955. Not because the white people were so liberal, it's just there were so few black people, it was ridiculous to have a separate school system. So I started school in 1956, and I went to white schools all my life. But it was socially segregated, residentially segregated. So the next day, the 4th of July, 1960, we went to the colored cookout. The white people went to the white cookout. And on the way home, I asked my dad to stop at Red Bull's newsstand. And he said, what do you want to get? And I said, I want to buy a composition book. And that night in front of the TV, I interviewed my mother and my father about their family tree. I wanted to know what my connection was to this lady. And I interviewed my mother, and I could go back about three generations from my mom and about an equivalent amount of generations on my dad's side. Now, I fell in love with genealogy that day. And I stayed in love with genealogy. I was just a little kid, so sometimes I'd put the composition book away, I'd get bored, I would lose it, then I would buy another composition book and sit down, interview my parents all over again. But I never lost this passion for my genealogy, and I particularly wanted to know why all these men that I descended from looked white. My dad also looked like a white man. Well, cut to 1977. 1976, Alex Haley publishes this book, Roots. 1977 was the biggest event in the history of television, Roots, the ABC miniseries. And like all you all who were old enough or alive at that time, you know, I watched 6 episodes of Roots just like you did. You could say that since 1977, I've had a serious case of Roots envy. I wanted to be like Alex Haley. I wanted to know what tribe or ethnic group I was from in Africa. I wanted to know what boat my ancestors came over on. I used to see ads for coats of arms, family coats of arms, in the back of the Washington Post Sunday magazine, like the Gates family, $50, you get a coat of arms. But I knew it wasn't my coat of arms. It wasn't my family. There would be something dishonest about embracing that. I wanted to know my complicated ancestry, but how could you do that? Well, Alex Haley did it. So I wanted to be like Alex Haley, but the only problem was nobody could do it like Alex Haley. And you know, many scholars, many historians don't think Alex Haley really did it. But I got to know Alex Haley and through Quincy Jones, and Alex Haley was a friend of mine. So I'm frequently asked by the press, what do you think of Alex Haley's work? And I say, Alex Haley was a friend of mine. He went to his grave believing that he had found the ethnic group he was from in the Gambia in West Africa. And since I can't replicate his research, that's good enough for me. But I figured nobody could do it. If Alex Haley did it, only Alex Haley could do it. Nobody else would be able to find a continuous link between themselves today and the original African who got off the boat and then reverse the Middle Passage metaphorically and find your tribe or ethnic group. The year 2000, I get a letter from Dr. Rick Kittles, a geneticist at Howard University. And he said that scientists had perfected this new technique through your mitochondrial DNA, which you inherit from your mother. It's an identical genetic fingerprint, a genetic signature. And yours is the same as your mother, whether you are a man or you're a woman. And hers is the same as her mother's, and hers is the same as her mother's, all the way back. And using this technique, and we'll talk about it a little bit later, using this technique, you could find out where your mother's 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 mother came from. Down even, he said, to the tribe or the ethnic group. And he was looking for well-known African-American men to be guinea pigs for this study. So I said, I am down. And he said he was having a difficult time attracting a sufficient pool of black men to do this. Now, I couldn't figure out why, but I was soon to find out why. But he came up, he was so excited, he jumped on a plane from Washington and flew up to Boston, came over to Cambridge, to my house in Harvard Square, the next day. Now, after, I soon figured out why. You can't really see in this light, but I have fantastic veins. And I've had about a zillion operations on my leg, and I just close my eyes, the needle just finds its way into my bloodstream. But after 45 minutes, I understood why Rick Kittles did not have any other black men who had signed up for this test. You see, Rick Kittles is many things. He's a brilliant geneticist, but he's not a brilliant extractor of blood. So after 30 minutes had gone by and he couldn't find the vein, I said, damn, Rick, this Kunta Kinte stuff is too much work. I don't want to know my African origins that bad. But finally, you see, in those days, to get a sufficient amount of DNA, they had to take big vials of blood. Now you just spit in a test tube, they swab your cheek. But then that's not the way it was, you know, 11 years ago. So finally, he gets enough blood, he jumps on a plane and flies back to Washington. 6 months come and go, and I don't hear from Rick Kittles. I call this brother almost every day. I'm calling him in his lab at Howard, and he won't answer the phone. Finally, I called from another number. He said, oh, this is Rick Kittles. I said, Skip Gates. He goes, man, I was just about to call you. I go, Rick, what are you doing? I want my Kunta Kinte moment. Where am I from in Africa? And he said, oh man, your results were so anomalous that we had to run the test over and over again. But I'm now prepared to tell you, you are descended from a woman female slave who was of the Nubian tribe or ethnic group. Now, all African Americans want to be either Zulu, descended from a Zulu person, or a Nubian. Why? They want the Zulu, under Chaka Zulu, they kicked the English in the behind. So, you know, the Boer Wars, they were tough and ferocious. So you want to be descended from the warrior class, right? Or the Nubians. Now, who are the Nubians? In the Bible, the kingdom of Cush, that's Nubia. If you Google Taharqa, Taharqa was one of the great black pharaohs. People argue all the time, in particularly in Afrocentric circles, about what the Egyptians look like. Well, the one thing we know is that the Nubians look like the black people in this room. And the Nubians and the Egyptians fought each other all the time. But the 25th dynasty, which obtained basically between about 750 BC and about 650 BC, definitely was a black dynasty. And if you Google Taharqa, Taharqa is in the book of Isaiah. And he was the great pharaoh, and so was Pianki. They were the two great black pharaohs. So all the Afrocentrists want to be descended from the black pharaohs. And Rick Kittle said, this was why we had to run your test, because we have 2,200 people in our database, and you're the only one descended from the black pharaoh. And he said, and all the Afrocentrists, especially Malefi Asante, they want to be Nubians. Now, Malefi and I are friends, but we fight a lot intellectually in public. But this was too good for me to pass up. And I said, are you sure he's not descended from the Nubian prince? He's not a Nubian prince like me? And Kittle said, no, you're the only one. So I picked up the phone. I got Malefi at home. I said, yo, Malefi, where are you from, brother, in Africa? I am the true Nubian prince. Eat your heart out. Well, Rick Kittle sent me a certificate saying that I was descended from Nubian people. I have a frame. Put it up in my living room. My dear friend Anthony Appiah, who is a great philosopher, who was at the now at Princeton, unfortunately, his uncle was the Asantehene, the king of the Asante people in Ghana. And his grandfather was Sir Stafford Cripp. So he was an aristocrat on his mother's side, an aristocrat on his father's side. He looked at my certificate saying I was descended from a Nubian prince, and he looked at me and he said, what a ton of rubbish. And I said, you're just jealous. I am the prince. I am the prince. That's just the way it is. So I forgot all about it. Now, I got up in the middle of the night about, I don't know, a couple months later. I got up, I have to say, might be indelicate, but I got up to go to the bathroom. As I was standing there in the bathroom, I had one of the best ideas that I've ever had in my whole life. I could combine this passion I had since July 3rd, 1960, the day I saw my grandfather in his casket, the passion for my own family tree, with this new science of ancestry tracing through genetics. And I could do a series, I could get 8 prominent African Americans, and I would do their family tree back to slavery. And then when the paper trail ran out, I would do their DNA and announce what tribe they were from in Africa. And I was so excited. And so the next day I called Quincy Jones. Now, Quincy was a jazz musician. So he basically lives like a vampire. You know, he's up all night long, the sun comes up, he goes to sleep, right? So you know you can't do business with Quincy till about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I waited, I was so excited. I mean, really, this is one of the most exciting days of my life. So I called Quincy, and Quincy scored the music for Roots. That's why I met Alex Haley through Quincy Jones. And he had wanted to have his family tree done. So I said, Q, what if I could do for you what Alex Haley did for himself? Would you be in a PBS documentary? Of course, I didn't have any money. I just had this idea. And he said, could you do that? And I said, yeah, I could do it. And he said, does it hurt? And I did what you would have done. I said, no, man, it doesn't hurt. Doesn't hurt at all. He said, I'm down. So I didn't want to appear to be crass or attempting to exploit our relationship. So I waited a few beats in this phone conversation. Who's Quincy's best friend? Oprah Winfrey. So I said, Q, would you ask Oprah if she would be in the series? He said, no. But he said, I'll do you one better. I'll give you her secret name and address. And I said, what am I supposed to do with that? He said, write her a letter. So I sat down and I wrote Oprah Winfrey. No, I didn't know Oprah Winfrey. I'd met her once briefly through Quincy Jones. I mean, for 50 seconds. That was it. She didn't know me from Adam. So I thought this was just a polite brush off. So I wrote this letter, and I forgot about it. Well, a week later, it was Sunday. My cell phone rang, and it said, Quincy Jones is calling. So I said, Q, what's up? And a deep woman's voice said, Dr. Gates, this is Oprah Winfrey. I went, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, my God. You see, students, rich people don't call you with bad news. They have somebody else call you. They only call you with good news. If you don't hear, you didn't get the job. You can forget it. She was in. Now, why did I need Quincy Jones and Oprah Winfrey? I needed $6 million to do African American Lives. All right? So, basically, I needed celebrities in order to pull this off. So my first pitch was to the Coca-Cola company. And I walked in and I said, how would you like your product associated with the whole world knowing what part of Africa Oprah Winfrey's ancestors came from? You know what that effect was like? You see that ceiling? Imagine that ceiling opening up and a giant ATM machine just descending. $6 million, is that all you need? And the result was African American Lives. Whoopi Goldberg heard that we were doing the series, called my office over and over again, and demanded to be in. The guy in the top middle is Dr. Ben Carson. Many of you know him. Ben is the chief of pediatric neurosurgery at Johns Hopkins, the first neurosurgeon successfully to separate Siamese twins and joined at the brain. He and I met September 1969. We were in that same class at Yale. Very religious man, by the way. That's in the right-hand corner, Mae Jemison, also a medical doctor. Stanford African Studies major, got a medical degree, first black woman astronaut. That's Quincy in the middle, Oprah, Bishop T.D. Jakes in under Quincy. I wanted a different range of colors, different phenotypes within the race. And T.D. Jakes was very dark. He was also a man of the cloth. I wanted that. And he's my homeboy from West Virginia. Can't beat that. Chris Tucker had seen my Africa series and came to visit me, and I really like Chris Tucker. And then Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot is a very distinguished sociologist at Yale. And 8 million people watched the series. It was a miracle. And so we got the funding to do African American Lives 2, and which was even bigger. And then I got a letter from a woman who happened to be Jewish and of Russian descent. And she wrote to me and she said, you're supposed to be Mr. Multiculturalism. So why are you only doing black people's family tree? And I'm like, oh my God, you know. And so I thought about it and I talked to my family and then I talked to my sponsors. And I said, why don't I expand the brand? And so I did the Noah's Ark approach. What's the Noah's Ark approach? To Jews, to Muslims, to Asians, to... And the result was Faces of America. Now, I wanted to share with you some of the lessons that I learned, I have learned in doing these series. There's a group of historians, we funded them at the Du Bois Institute to get them started, but under the direction of Dr. David Eltis at Emory University. And they have counted the slaves. And we now know that between 1502 and 1866, 12.5 million Africans were shipped out of Africa to the New World. 15% die in the Middle Passage, 11.2 billion land in the New World. This slide says that over 5 million were shipped directly from Africa to South America. In fact, 4.8 million went to Brazil alone. This slide says that just under 4.5 million slaves were shipped directly from Africa to the Caribbean. How many were shipped to the United States? 450,000. Only 450,000 Africans were shipped to the United States in the whole history of the slave trade. That is the most mind-boggling statistic I have ever encountered in my scholarly studies. All the rest went to the Caribbean and places in Latin America. And we now know where they came from. If I did the DNA of all the black people in this auditorium, 24% will come from ethnic groups from Senegal and Gambia, So, and that's where Alex Haley said he was from, so he had a 1 in 4 chance of being right. 11.6% from Sierra Leone, 11.6% from Ghana, 16.7% from Igbo land, eastern Nigeria, about 2.5% from the Yoruba people, Benin and western Nigeria, 5.6% from Liberia and the Ivory Coast. 1 in 4 black people in this room are descended from African ethnic groups from Angola. 1 in 4, and 2% from Mozambique. This database, you could look at all this, these data on the internet at the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database when you go home. But it's looked at over 35,000 voyages. It was capitalism. It kept fantastic records. But nobody had looked at them as a unit, and that's what we were able to do. How American are the African-American people? Well, by 1776, when Thomas Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence, 75% of our African ancestors had arrived here. By 1800, 80%, and by 1820, 99.7%. The African-American people are as American as you can get. Here's another amazing statistic. The black population in 1860, if you look at the federal census of 1860, there were 3.9 million slaves and 488,000 free colored people, as we would have said then. Now, here's what's interesting. If you look at those 488,000 free black people, there were more free black people living in the slave states in 1860 than there were in the northern free states. There were 225,000 in the free states, 261,000 in the slave states. And they stayed in the slave states all during the Civil War, largely unmolested. You know, if you read African American literature, you think that all the slaves, as Ismael Reed jokes, the slaves were the first to read, the first to write, were the first to run away. Wasn't that way. The more free Negroes stayed in the South. Why? Because when your master freed you, he had to give you land. So what are you going to do? Leave your land and move to New York and what? Be homeless? That wasn't going to happen. Leave your friends? No way. So the history of race and race relations is much more complex than the simple cartoon sort of notions that were given in elementary school. Now, for each of the guests, we give the men 3 tests and we give the women 2 tests. Why the men 3 tests? Because all men have Y DNA. That's what makes us men. So we test the man's Y DNA. We test the mitochondrial DNA of the men and women. And I told you earlier, that's what you get from your mother. Your Y DNA you get from your father. It too is an identical genetic fingerprint. And then the third test is we call the pie chart, or your admixture, which is your percentage of African ancestry, European ancestry, and Native American or Asian ancestry. And it's so funny, when I pitched this series, I pitched it around the idea that the guest would want to know what tribe or ethnic group they were from in Africa. But far more people are interested, just as you said, in their African American ancestors back in the slavery and in their admixture, in what their genetic percentages are. So this is how we do these DNA tests. This is the number of ancestors you have in the 6th generation. 1 of you, 2 parents, 4 grandparents, 8 great-grandparents. At your 4th great-grandparents, great-great-great-great-grandparents, you have 64 4th great-grandparents. Now, here's how genetic markers are passed down the generations. Your Y DNA is passed down from a father to his sons, and your mitochondrial DNA is passed down from a mother to her children. If we test people, say, in Ireland or test people in Africa, we put their haplogroup in a computer, as it were, and if we test you and test you and test you and you have a match, it means you descend from someone who is of the same ethnic group. It's as simple as that. You share a common ancestor. So if you test someone who says they're Igbo and you have an exact match, then that means that you are descended on your mother's side from someone who was an Igbo. If it's, you could have the Udinho haplotype, and we'll hear a little bit more about that in a minute. That means that you're descended from Ireland, and you have a common genetic signature with 8% of the men in this case of Ireland. Now, doing this series, I've established the 3 great myths of African American genealogy. The first and the second are fundamentally related, and they are that I am descended from an Igbo princess, and we were never slaves. Now, the first time I heard the first two, I was on Martha's Vineyard having dinner. It was just about 3 years ago. And it was at a very prominent African-American home. I won't say who it was. And I turned to this man's wife, and I said, how far can you trace your family back to slavery? And she looked at me, and she said, we're not descended from slaves. And I went, wow, this is going to be good. You know, what'd you do, come on the Mayflower? You know what I'm talking about? But the woman was cooking the food, and I didn't want her to throw me out because I was really hungry. So I was very polite, and I like to be polite anyway. And so I said, well, could you tell me how you're not descended from slaves? She said, well, it's a great story. I'm glad you asked. She said, this slave ship came into Charleston, South Carolina, and this beautiful, beautiful Igbo princess is being unloaded from the boat. And this German baron is walking by and looks over and says, my, look at that fine Igbo prince. She is so beautiful. I don't want her foot, her dainty foot, to touch the foul soil of slavery. So he goes over and buys her. They fall madly in love and live happily ever after in the North. And I looked at her like, are you kidding me? You know, but I didn't say anything. That's the way it was. The next day, you all know Malcolm Gladwell, the great Malcolm Gladwell, whose mother is Jamaican, and he was in my last series, Faces of America. I called Malcolm to see if he would be in the last series, and he said he would, and I said, Malcolm, tell me, how much do you know about your ancestry? He said, oh, man, I'm going to tell you, it's the greatest story. I am descended from an Igbo princess. And I go, really? He goes, yeah, man, there was this German baron. He was walking by us. The third great myth is my grandmother had high cheekbones and straight black hair. I am descended from the Native American. I want the African Americans in this room to raise your hand. Don't be ashamed. We're in the era of multiculturalism. How many of you are descended from Native Americans? Brothers, honest, you put your hand up. Come on. Well, if y'all can see, like, every black person in this room is putting their hand up. None of y'all are descended from Native Americans. 5% of the African American people, only 5%, have a sufficient amount of Native American ancestry to claim to be descended from Native American. First off, the last time I checked, you got to be able to see somebody to sleep with them. You know what I'm talking about? The average slave and the average Native American never saw each other. Never saw. Of all the people we tested, only Oprah Winfrey and Chris Tucker had a significant amount of Native American ancestry. But I'm going to tell you why your grandmother, your great-grandmother, had high cheekbones and straight black hair. It's because of our admixture. The average admixture for African Americans, 77% African, 17.5% European, and only 4.9% Native American. If I did the DNA of all the black men in this room, all the black men in the NBA, all the black men in America, 35% descend not from a black man at all, but from a white man. These are the scientific facts. We are one of the most mixed peoples in the history of this country, all because of enforced sex under slavery. One in three of us has a white great-great or third-great grandfather because of slavery. 1% of the African American people have at least 50% European ancestry. 19.6% of the African American people have at least 25% European ancestry. That's the equivalent of one grandparent. 58% of the African American people have at least 12.5% European ancestry. That's the equivalent of one great grandparent. And 5%, only 5% of the African American people have at least 12.5% Native American ancestry. Again, the equivalent of one great grandparent. But we all think that we have a Native American ancestor. And why? Because it's a lot easier to fantasize about a Native American ancestor than to think about rape, to think about enforced sexuality under slavery, which led to all of our mixed race features. And that's the analysis when I asked Chris Rock why he thought that we all wanted to be Native American so badly. And that's what he said, that it was too painful to contemplate what actually happened. So we made it up. It's like my Uncle David. My Uncle David said, boy, I don't like that series you did because they gave you your test and we didn't have any Native American ancestry. He said, we are definitely Native Americans. Now, my grandmother, I'm a Redman on my mother's side of the family, and I'm a Redman, R-E-D-M-A-N, my father's side of the family. So you'd think that's a slam dunk to be Native American, right? Well, I'll tell you what, I'll show you my results in a minute. But so I said to my uncle, if we're Native American, what's our tribe? He goes, Cherokee. Now, I grew up in, as I told you, in the hills of West Virginia. I said, well, Erky, that's pretty good, but except the Cherokee down in Georgia. He said, oh, yeah, that's right, Iroquois. Yeah, I said, the Iroquois are up in New York State. Now, I promised Jeannie that I wouldn't walk away from the podium, but I'm going to do this for a minute. I'm going to show you when, and I'm almost finished, and then we'll take questions. I'm going to show you what I learned when I did my own research when I was 9 years old, and then this great gift of ancestry that the Mormons have given to me. All that I was able to trace.
Here I am, and here's Mama, and Big Mom, and Greg, so I can go back that far. And then on the gate side, here I am, that's Daddy, that's Pop, that's Pat, and that's Jamie. That's all the part that I can get. All the rest of these people, all of my virtual ancestors,
have been given back to me by the Mormon genealogists. You all know why, and we use Mormon genealogists to do the series. The President of the Mormon Church had a revelation in 1839. And that revelation involved the capacity to, if they could trace your ancestors, they could baptize them and make them Mormons. And so the Mormons have been fascinated, riveted by genealogy since that time. The Mormons will show up and, you know, at a Catholic church, and the priest will come to the door and they'll say, we'll copy all of your records, your baptisms, your confirmations, communion records, your marriages, deaths, all over the world. There are trillions of records, billions and billions and billions of records in the Mormon family library, and they are the world's greatest genealogists. And if you go to Ancestry.com, all of these things have now been digitized, or a lot of these records have been digitized, and so you can trace your family tree too. The most embarrassing thing that happened to me doing the series was when they revealed my admixture results. I told you I would come back to this. At the time, I was the chairman of African American Studies at Harvard, and they announced to 8 million people that the chairman of Black Studies at Harvard was half a white man. It gave me the blues, but then I didn't know if I was black enough to have the blues. And what I really worried about was losing my affirmative action money. Then to make me feel better, they took my African genes, as it were, I'm speaking loosely here, and analyzed them to tell me where I was from. They did a special test. And as you can see, 49% comes from Western Nigeria, the Yoruba people. And that's the ethnic group that I know the most about. Now, what about Jane Gates' son and grandson? You know, Pop Gates was so white, we called him Casper behind his back. Well, this is my Y-DNA. You see, you're not looking at a map of Africa. You're looking at a map of Europe. Look at that egg yolk kind of graphic. It's over Ireland. I have the Unio haplotype, which means Jane Gates, as I said, had 5 children. She never told her children the identity of their father. She only told them that they had the same father. And we now know through my Y-DNA that he was an Irishman. My Y-DNA, my brother's Y-DNA, my father's Y-DNA is identical with 8% of the men in Ireland. We all descend from a king called Niall, N-I-A-L-L, of the 9 hostages. All you can figure out, this guy lived, well, not even sure if he was mythic or if he lived, but whoever he was, he slept with everybody in his kingdom. You know, they say it's good to be the king. Well, that's like my 20th great-great-grandfather. So on my father's side, I'm descended from a white man. Remember that Nubian result? I'm going to show you, and then we'll end. Why did Rick Kittles say that I was descended from the Nubian people? Nobody, no black Americans are descended from the Zulu people, and none are descended from the Nubian people, because there were no slaves that came from Nubia. Nubia runs from Khartoum, the capital of Sudan, up to the second cataract, the Aswan Dam. What did my ancestor walk all the way across the Sahara Desert to jump on a boat, what, to go pick cotton in Alabama? I mean, you know, do I look stupid to you guys? You know, like, I don't think so. And none of our ancestors that came in that 450,000 were Zulu either. Oprah wanted to be Zulu so much, we gave her the test. She went to South Africa the next day, had a rally, and announced that she was going to build the Oprah Winfrey Leadership Academy. And at the same time, just moved by the Holy Ghost, I guess, she told them that she was Zulu. Now, I'm sitting at home watching this on CNN. And I called Rick Kittles, and I said, did you tell Oprah she was a Zulu? And he said, no, why? I said, because she just told the whole world that she's a Zulu. And he said, no, man, I wonder where she got that. I go, I don't know. But I said, Rick, are you in your lab? He goes, yeah. I said, is anybody else there? He said, no. I said, make her a Zulu. I'm going to show you why he said I was a Nubian.
Right here. Look at that. You see all these diamonds? Yeah.
Who was living in Alexandria. Look at Europe. It looks like Europe has smallpox. Look over the United Kingdom. You see that huge red dot? All those people and I have identical mitochondrial DNA. What that means is that I am one of the few African Americans who's not only descended from a white man who impregnated a black woman, I'm descended from a white woman who was impregnated by a black man. I'm descended from one of those indentured servants from England or Ireland, look at the location, who was impregnated in the 17th century by a black slave. If a Martian came down and just looked at my mitochondrial results and my Y-DNA results, I'm a white man. It's the damnedest thing I ever saw. I called Rick and I said, why did you tell me that I was Nubian? He said, I didn't want to hurt your feelings. Well, it's been quite an adventure. Now, I convened a working group of genealogists and geneticists and historians, and we meet at Harvard, and we're planning a curriculum. What we want to do is revolutionize the way that we teach science and social studies to inner city brown and black kids. When we were growing up in the 50s, the blackest thing you could be was a doctor or lawyer, not a basketball player or an entertainer. Too many of our people have lost their way. What's your favorite subject? Your favorite subject is yourself. The study of genealogy, the study of genetics is just another way of understanding yourself, the complexity of yourself, of who you are. So what we're trying to do is revolutionize how we teach science to the inner city kids. If we walked in to, if the three of us walked into an inner city school tomorrow and said, today's lesson is Watson and Crick and the double helix, people would say, get out of town. But if we said, see this Q-tip? You're going to swab your cheek. In 6 weeks, you're going to know what tribe your ancestor came from, Africa. And while we wait for the results, we're going to study how the science works. Then we're going to go down the hall to the social studies teacher. And each student is going to have to do their family tree. You're going to have an electronic family tree. They're going to go home and interview their mother, their father. They come back and put the first rung of the tree up. Then their grandparents, the second rung. After 1930, all the censuses are in the public domain. So then we'll show them how to access the censuses on the internet, or if there is an archive, you know, a state archive, we could go down and do that. And they're going to trace, just as you said, any black American get back to 1870. That is when our slave ancestors first appeared in the census with two names. And we can take them back to 1870, and then we can look in 1860 in the same county like we did for Oprah Winfrey and find a white man who owned, because we found Constantine Winfrey, her great-great-grandfather, living with his wife Violet in Atala County, Mississippi. right next to a white man named Absalom Winfrey. 10 years before, Absalom Winfrey owned a slave 10 years younger than Constantine. You don't have to be Sherlock Holmes to figure out that was the same guy. Sometimes we could even find the white man who owned you. We believe that using this new curriculum, that we can revolutionize the attitude of inner city black kids who have lost their way and reignite that passion for education that all of us, that all of our people had when we were growing up in the 1950s and the 1960s. Martin Luther King didn't die so that a small percentage of the black community, because of affirmative action, becomes a new black middle class, leaving all those black children behind. We think that we can, through this new curriculum, make a contribution to solving the class divide within the African-American people. And I don't know if we will be able to do it or not, but at least we're going to try not to take our people back to the future, but hoping to take our people black to the future. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Anybody have a first question? Yes, here on the left.
Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Willie Amoson. We have a local mentoring program for our young men and women. And your last comment there about their ability to help those young men find out who they are. How do you propose to put that in operation? How does that look? Can you give me a little bit of insights to how that might work?
Yeah, right now we're just working on the curriculum. Because we, you know, we're all Harvard professors and we never did a real world curriculum, you know, for school kids, right? So it's very perplexing. How do we do that? So once we get the curriculum down, which will be very soon, we've had hundreds of school systems apply to be guinea pig. So we'll probably pick three. Okay. You know, West Coast, Central, East Coast, and then try it out. Okay. You know, there are privacy issues that you have to deal with. Some people don't want to know. You know, some people don't want their kids even thinking about DNA tests. I asked a prominent basketball player to be in the new series. And he said, yeah. Then I said, we're going to give you a DNA test. He said, oh, no. And you know why, you know, paternity issues. But we don't... Basketball players have a lot of free time. But we don't get into all that. I'll tell you something funny. When I did Tina Turner, I mean, that didn't come out right. That was a subconscious desire. I wanted to do her DNA myself, but she wouldn't let me. You know, you have to change the reel after 18 minutes. You know, we had to break. She had to put her makeup on and everything. And so she said, oh, I'm so relieved. I said, well, why? Miss Turner, I called her that. She said, no, call me Tina. I go, okay, why? And she said, I thought you were going to say my daddy wasn't my daddy. That's what all the black people said, my daddy wasn't my daddy. Then when I gave her admixture results and I said that she was 35% white, she said, she was so sad. And I go, there's nothing wrong with that. Most black people have white ancestors. She said, no, that's not it. She said, Ike always said that I thought I was white. I acted white. And it's going to please him when he sees this. And then she said, well, wait a minute. She said, when's the series going to air? This was in the summer. And I said, it was July. We were at her house in Nice in the south of France. And I said, it'll be on Black History Month in February. She said, oh, Ike will be dead by that time, so don't worry about it. And we're like, whoa, okay. Yes.
Hi, I have a genetics question. So at the end of Faces of America, you and your father both had your entire genome sequenced.
That's right.
You got a little bit of results from the scientists, and I was just wondering if you've gotten any more feedback from them, if they've done any more analysis and done any more studies since then.
No, what we're doing, I'm so glad you asked that. Because I have this O'Neill haplotype, I also, and it's complicated to explain, but let's say you can do a 67 marker test for your haplotypes, right? But we have, my father, my brother, and I have three mutations, different than anybody else in, you know, all these 8% of the men in Ireland and I have are all in this same haplogroup, except we have these three unique markers, which we got from the white man who impregnated Jane Gates. So what we're doing is we're advertising for Henry Louis Gates is looking for his great-great-granddaddy. If you are Irish and live and you descend from a man who lived in Allegheny County, Maryland during the Civil War or 1850s, 1860, we'll give you a free DNA test. And because it was up there in the hills of West Virginia, Maryland. And with a little luck, one there's somebody walking around with these three identical mutations to mine. And when we find that person, we will know who impregnated Jane Gates. And that would be a great thing. So for each of the series, I go to her grave and I say, I'm going to find him, Jane. I'm going to find out who he was.
Yeah, good luck.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Like my father has passed away, and he had no brothers or sisters or anybody, and so you can we will never be able to find out the part of his family. His
no,
mother.
You need a male-to-male.
Male-to-male.
If he had an uncle with a son, right? You just need a male descendant from the progenitor. Hmm. So, if your father did he have any brothers at all? No.
He's an only child.
Then
it's just lost.
That's
right?
The Y DNA is going to be lost.
I mean, but Genia, but
tracing your mitochondria,
back, you can be able to find his family through records, basically.
Oh yeah, you could do the family tree part, mm-hmm. But you're not going to find where his Y DNA comes right. from. But you'll find your mitochondrial DNA is the
right.
same.
I've
as your
had
mom.
That done, but I'm trying to figure out what. The record says. So oh. It's a mystery right now.
Oh, okay.
But I'm learning. I'm
okay.
trying to learn.
Well, tell me what the result is when we sign the books and I'll tell you what it means.
Oh.
Okay, great. Yes.
I have a bit of a literature and education question for you.
Okay.
Are you familiar with the New South edition of Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn?
No. Oh, is that the one when they take out nigger?
Correct.
I think that's the stupidest thing I ever heard of in my whole life. Yeah. I mean, black people would say, nigger, please. I had to put that in there. You know that.
Yeah, I concur with your...
Censorship is to art as lynching is to justice. You can't tamper. It's a teaching opportunity. Now, I don't want to get into teachable moments because that make people start talking about beer summits and stuff like that.
I think you've pretty much answered what I was going to ask. I was going to ask for reactions about it. But,
I think it's stupid.
Yeah.
You know, you have to, if you're going to study Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer, you have to understand what the words mean. You can't protect people. I teach a big lecture course, Introduction to African American Studies, a team teaching. And this is about 2 months ago, one of the TFs, we have five TFs and each one has to give a lecture, part of their training. And the woman, it was a lynching, and she just didn't want the students to see the lynching. Well, how are you going to teach African American history then? I'd see the lynch. You know, you have to show the unpleasant sides and the pleasant sides. I mean, we're training young adults. We're training people to think. We have to understand what these words mean, how they came to signify, how they can hurt, how painful it is. You know, it is a teaching opportunity, and we can't censor the tradition. That's irresponsible. That's what I think.
Thank you.
You're welcome. By the way, I'm sorry KU lost. I am. I'm sorry. I was rooting for you, man, and the brothers were there crying. I went, oh, man, that's... That was bad. Yes?
Has March 17th taken on any
new... Oh, my Irish heritage? Yeah, I'm a brother, you know, Irish brother. Guinness tastes better. I told you I grew up in Irish-Italian... Paper mill town. I used to go to the Catholic Church just to look at this one Irish girl, so I guess I was drawn genetically. But you see, we're exploding notions of these fixed ethnic identities. The great thing that I love is the admixture test, because it shows how mixed up we all are. And that's really quite wonderful. No matter what your little ethnic bailiwick was in the day, when the lights came down, everybody was getting down with everybody else. That's what admixture test shows. Yes.
Yeah, I have a question about the DNA testing that definitively tells you a tribal group in Africa. How do you...
That part's very controversial.
Well, right. Yeah, I was going to ask you how you felt about the controversy in defining a tribal group in one place over a long period of time.
I think that... you see, the problem is Rick Kittles is the person who says he can tell you what tribe you're from. But his database is private, which is against all the, most fundamental, assumption of science, right? That you can replicate someone else's results. So that if I have an African American, I will have them tested by Rick's company. But I started my own company with Family Tree DNA. Now, obviously, I can't use that company. That would be a conflict of interest. But I'll have other people test. In fact, this chart was done by Peter Forster, who is a Cantabrigian. I mean, he's a geneticist at Cambridge. And he was the one who told me that whoever told me that I was descended from a Nubian was crazy, because look at the map. And I realized, my God, I was about to go on TV not knowing what I was talking about. So I've since taken two genetics courses, and I'm a member of the Personal Genome Project. So that what I'll do is I'll tell people, according to this database and according to this company, but the results are private, so we can't replicate them. But everyone else will tell you your broader haplogroup, which is not the tribe, but it's the region of Africa that you're from. You're West African, or where in West Africa. And that's really accurate. I mean, there's no controversy about that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, please do join us for the reception and book signing. I'm sure you'll want to join me in thanking Dr. Gates for a splendid evening.
Thank you.